So does the PIRADS score have anything to do with staging prostate cancer, or does it really just show us whether or not we should get a biopsy?
Well, initially it's been used to decide who does need a biopsy. And just for clarity, the PIRADS system is a numbering system from 1 to 5. The higher numbers indicate a greater likelihood that the spot that they're seeing in the prostate with the MRI is something that is above a Gleason 6. And that would be considered actionable prostate cancer. There are studies that have looked at people on active surveillance who have visible lesions with the PIRADS system and shown that the likelihood of going off of active surveillance because of a higher Gleason score discovered later is greater in people that have visible lesions and in people that have higher scores on the lesions that are seen, higher PIRADS scores. So it does have some predictive power. There's also some suggestion that people with higher PIRADS scores have higher relapse rates after surgery and radiation and or radiation. And the PIRADS system, the MRI methodology for detecting these lesions is useful for detecting someone that has a higher risk type of cancer. And this does seem to be independent from the biopsies and how high the PSA is and the other factors that we've used to try and predict the future. So it's not something that I rely upon heavily because I don't think that the degree of the power of the information is that great. So you can, in large studies, you can show that there's predictive power with these PIRADS lesions and that having a PIRADS 5 will place you at a little higher risk of disease progression someday compared to, say, a PIRADS 4 or in a situation where people don't see anything at all. But I think that the likelihood that it's going to change the selection of therapy, in other words, you'll start managing someone more aggressively because of this information, no. I think it's more theoretical and not, I'm not using it, practically speaking, in my day-to-day practice.
So the main information then that you're using would be Gleason and PSA, right?
Yeah, when you're talking, it's different roles in different situations, but that's correct. So if you're trying to decide what to do for a newly diagnosed patient, should they have radiation or should they go on active surveillance? Yes, we rely upon the Gleason score and how high the PSA is. And how many core biopsies are positive if they had a random biopsy. MRIs are useful for detecting disease in seminal vesicles or occasionally even in lymph nodes. And of course, that drives the decision-making process. But we're not using the PIRADS system to decide who should get more or less aggressive cancer treatment.
Thank you for clarifying that. I know when it comes to staging, there's a lot of confusion. I think people are trying to figure out what to do, and we've actually created a tool for that. If you would like more information about staging and the treatments available to you, you can go ahead and answer our quiz. Basically, you answer 6 questions, and it'll tell you what stage you are and the treatments available to you. You can go ahead and click that on the link below. So how useful would you say 3T MRI is for figuring out if there's cancer in the pelvic nodes? Would you go ahead and go straight to a PSMA since that was recently approved? This person is trying to avoid radiation altogether, and I think they're concerned if there is pelvic node involvement that they'll go ahead and need to do that.
Well, until PSMA came along and we were using Axumin PET scans, although they weren't always covered for people that are newly diagnosed, they were used more to detect lymph node disease in people that were relapsing after surgery or radiation. But the accuracy of MRI and CT to detect lymph nodes in the pelvis is probably comparable. And MRI and CT use a size criteria. If the lymph node gets really chubby and lumpy and big, they say if it's over a half inch across, then they start thinking, wow, that's just too big for a lymph node. Must be cancer. The criteria for detecting cancer in the lymph nodes is pretty crude if you use MRI or CT. It's, of course, scans were done routinely because if you do have a big lump of cancer that you do want to know about it. But all the precautions that have been taken through the years to handle the possibility that there's cancer out there that's not being seen on MRIs and CTs has, you know, built up this whole high risk, intermediate risk categories. And all that is talking about the risk of spread. And of course, the most common site of spread is the lymph nodes. So yeah, they've been pretty unsatisfying through the years that If someone has a clear scan with an MRI or CT, it does not mean there's no cancer in the lymph nodes. And that's been well understood for a long time. As you point out, the PSMA PET scans and to some degree Axumin PET scans are a whole new world. And how we're going to incorporate that into our management of people with higher Gleason scores is still undecided. People that have clear scans, can they avoid all the radiation and maybe the hormone therapy? Studies have yet to be conclusively performed in that regard, but it sure seems to make a lot of sense.
So now that PSMA is approved and covered by insurance for the most part, do we see Axumin, how do we place that? When would that be used in the process of diagnosis? Would that be the first go-to and then a PSMA?
So Axumin PET scans aren't as accurate as PSMA PET scans at low PSA levels, so which is, say, less than one or two. And PSMA really outshines Axumin PET scans at that level. As the PSA starts going higher, all scans start working better. Axumin works better. Even CTs and MRIs start working better because the cancer metastases are getting larger. So I'd say at very low PSAs, you definitely want to use PSMA. Higher PSAs, Axumin's not bad. Another thing to consider is that in about 10% of men, their cancers don't make the PSMA molecule, and so therefore their cancers are not going to be showing up on a PSMA PET scan. So if someone has a clear PSMA PET scan and their PSA is high enough to where you think there's significant likelihood of lymph node metastasis, I think it's a very logical time to get an Axumin PET scan and see if it's a non-PSMA producing cancer. That the reason that nothing was seen on that PSMA PET scan is not because there's no cancer there, but because they have a type of cancer that is not making PSMA. So we know that's about 10% of men with prostate cancer. So Axumin will still have a role for those situations, but I think the first go-to scan, now that it's FDA approved and now it's covered by Medicare, is going to be PSMA.
For that small 10% who don't make that PSMA molecule, are there genomic tests that'll tell people ahead of time that they should automatically be getting, or is it just that if it doesn't show up in the lymph node involvements there, or the PSA is high, that you're just automatically going to do an Axumin scan?
Yeah, I'm not aware of any assays right now. I suppose one could go back and look at the original biopsy specimen in the prostate and see if it stains for PSMA. But the problem with that is that as cancers progress and spread, they change genetically. They can mutate. So it may not match what was in the original biopsy specimen. So I think it's just going to be, if we're suspicious when someone has a negative PSMA PET scan, then it'd be logical to get an Axumin PET scan or a C11 acetate PET scan, which uses a different technology than Axumin does. So these other PET scans, both C11 choline, and Axumin offer different methodology to try and look for lymph nodes in case the PSMA is missing something.
I know one conversation we've been having on our helpline a lot is we talk a lot about PSMA, but the centers that are doing it are not widespread across the country. There seems to be a few centers where Axumin is widespread in every state, it seems like, and there's a huge list on their website of centers that are doing it. So how do you see the, what rate do you see the centers opening up that are going to start doing PSMA now that it's covered?
Very rapidly. Company that, there's actually two companies that make PSMA type PET scans. I believe one is already commercialized. The other one will probably be commercialized within 6 months. So we should probably provide the phone number of that company. People can call the company and ask them, are there centers in their area that either are offering the PSMA PET scan or are going to be offering it soon? And I think that you'll find that this technology is going to spread very rapidly at this point.
Hey everybody, it's me and our dog, the PCRI mascot, Sir Hunter. You can go ahead and check out his Instagram and go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week.